And the last one is yours truly. Are you now ready, Attorney Cayuso?
Okay. Mr. Presiding Officer, good morning.
Yes, go ahead, please.
I have prepared a brief PowerPoint presentation, but if it's not possible to conduct one, I have hard copies, which I would like to provide to the members of the council.
Yeah, I think it's better that you give us the hard copies, because we may be running short of time. No? We cannot predict how long the questioning will take. It will depend on the answers that you will be giving. So I think it would be better that you give the hard copy then. Okay.
I will do that, Mr. Justice. But also, may I be, you know, in lieu of the presentation, can I be allowed to deliver a brief opening statement?
How long will it take?
I would say not longer than 10 minutes.
Can you shorten it? Let's say 3 minutes.
I will try my best.
Okay. Now that will right. Okay. Go ahead then, Dean.
Can I occupy the podium?
You prefer to be
in the middle, comfortable
in the middle. Yeah, considering your age, probably you are more comfortable standing. Okay, go ahead then.
Thank you very much. Mr. Presiding Officer, members of the Council, being the first to be interviewed, or perhaps using law school language, being the first to be called for recitation, is both a burden and a blessing. It is a burden because at this point, I have no idea what questions my JBC professors will be asking. As the youngest in the class, I was hoping to learn from, perhaps even copy from, my older classmates. But being the first to recite is also a blessing because one gets the opportunity to set the tone, provide a context, and perhaps even help frame the important issues relating to these proceedings. Indeed, choosing the next Chief Justice is a defining moment for the Philippine legal system. But while the importance of this changing of the guard cannot be gainsaid, we should not lose sight of our larger objective, which is to overhaul an ineffective, inefficient, and inadequate justice system. Indeed, this process should be less about choosing one person, but more about ensuring that genuine reforms are truly in place to achieve that objective. In the 2011 Global Competitiveness Report released by the World Economic Forum, the Philippines ranked the lowest among ASEAN countries in respect of the three main indicators of a functioning legal system. Back home, in the most recent SWS survey regarding public satisfaction with top government institutions, the Supreme Court's net satisfaction rating dropped by 14 points from plus 27 in March to plus 13 in May 2012. This is the lowest rating received by the court since 2005. And the court ranked the lowest as compared to the other branches of government, the Senate, the House of Representatives, and the Cabinet. The first step in solving any problem is to recognize that there is a problem. And the opposite to the saying, if it ain't broke, why fix it, is if it's broke, then we should fix it. I believe that the Philippine legal system faces four major challenges that all begin with the letter C: corruption, congestion/delay, competence, and credibility. Hoodlums in robes, it's not whether you know the law, but whether you know the judge, are phrases mouthed not just by legal practitioners, but by non-lawyers as well. With due respect to the honest and hardworking employees in the Philippine legal system, unfortunately, you have become the exception rather than the general rule. Congestion of court dockets and delay in deciding cases are kindred problems. 25 years ago, a legal command was made as follows: the Supreme Court shall, within 1 year after the ratification of this constitution, adopt a systematic plan to expedite the decision or resolution of cases or matters pending in the Supreme Court or the lower courts prior to the effectivity of this constitution. This command is contained in Article 18, Section 12 of the Transitory Provisions. In this regard, the latest figures as contained in the 2010 Supreme Court annual report show that the average disposition rate for all the courts for the entire judiciary is 39%. In other words, more than 60% of pending cases were not decided. It is quite apparent then that what has happened to that 25-year-old constitutional directive? Not much. I shudder when I think about the financial and economic repercussions that all this delay and congestion have caused. Unlike in the US and other developed countries, where top law school graduates vie for limited judicial clerkships, in the Philippines, the beeline is with the top Makati law firms. We all know that any agency, be it in the private or the public sector, is as good as the people who are in it. Hence, there must be a concerted effort on the part of the Supreme Court to hire and keep the best and brightest lawyers within the judicial ranks. On credibility, yes, the Supreme Court has the final say on what the Constitution and other laws mean, and that we are all duty-bound to obey its rulings. But the court should never forget that it remains accountable to the people and to the higher court of public opinion. Decisions that are perceived to be manifestly wrong, obtained through political, financial, or fraternal influence, or that flip-flop, chip away at the very credibility upon which the court ultimately anchors its authority upon. It is only right that if we identify challenges, we must also proactively propose solutions. To address the issues of corruption and competence, the first thing the Supreme Court should do is to mount an aggressive campaign to recruit the best and brightest lawyers and law students. This should be done fully realizing that its work is only as good as the people who do them. Towards this end, the three branches of government should work hand in hand to improve the compensation packages, equipment and tools, and court infrastructure, taking into account the workloads of judges, as well as the physical and reputational risk that their position entails.
Excuse me, Dean, can you now wind up?
Okay, Mr. Justice, just a few more minutes. Let me just go then. Well, I have a slew of solutions which perhaps can be asked later, but maybe just as a final statement before I am asked questions, I would like to say that really, to maintain and enhance its credibility, the Supreme Court should lead by example. It should wipe out its own backlog. It should be more transparent and accountable in the use of public funds. It's about time that the gods of Faura realize that they are more human and less divine. Every year, it should let the public know what its goals, objectives, and key results areas are. Thereafter, it should perhaps hold its own State of the Judiciary address and report on its performance. In short, the Supreme Court should exhibit not just political, but judicial will in creating a justice system that we can all be proud of. These are my initial thoughts on the challenges facing our legal system. I have a few more, but I do not wish to abuse the time given by the counsel. Mr. Presiding Officer, I'm now ready for recitation.
Okay, Attorney Cayusa, you want to remain standing? Can you endure more than an hour of standing with all the questions propounded to you, Dean? Or this time you'll be more comfortable sitting?
No, perhaps I will just remain standing. Well, I will try to endure best as I can, sir.
Okay. Attorney Cayusa then.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Before I propound my question, Mr. Chairman, may I just state for the record and disclose that I have known Chairman Bautista personally since the 1980s when we both served under the office of the Chief Justice, and that he was legal counsel of my father's campaign, and he is a personal friend, as I stated. Now, may proceed with my questions. Chairman Bautista, in the recent forum, and you reiterated today, you presented the pressing need for judicial reforms. In fact, you characterize our present justice system as inefficient, ineffective, and inadequate. What have you personally accomplished in your private or career life, a private public career rather, particularly as PCGG chairman, that would show that you have what it takes to head the Supreme Court, lead the branch toward the much-needed reforms, and to address the problems of inefficiency, inadequacy, and ineffectiveness?
Thank you very much for that question, Attorney Cayosa. You know, in fact, I have now been with the PCGG for close to 2 years, and I can say that the problems that we encountered coming in mirror the problems that are now facing our judicial system. That when we came in, the PCGG was ineffective, it was inefficient, and it was inadequate. So what we immediately did was we had to restore the credibility of the institution, because that was a main issue, that the very integrity of its creation was being questioned. Its past performance and track record was always being scrutinized. So what we did was that, first of all, I was very fortunate that I was able to convince like-minded, like-valued, and like-principled people to join me in the crusade. And the president was kind enough to appoint them. Second, again, we had to increase transparency and accountability in the way we did things. You know, after all, you know, our name is the Presidential Commission on Good Government. So we had to lead by example. So towards that end, we immediately revamped our website. We came out with a 100-day report. We also came out recently report. So we have been proactively speaking with and receiving feedback from our stakeholders, including other government agencies, coconut farmers, human rights victims, the media, and the general public. So in this respect, I think that the situation is similar, although, of course, the PCGG is a microcosm of the bigger problems involving our judicial system. One thing I would also like to say is that, really, when we came in, we've noticed that there are many faults that we found in the PCGG, and I must say some of these faults can be traced also to the problems of our judicial system. We still have a backlog of 276 cases, and this is after 26 years of existence. Just by way of an anecdote, we have 101 cases. And out of those 101 cases, the average length of time that these cases have been pending is 20 years, with the longest being 25 years. 64% of those 101 cases are more than 20 years old. So we have issues there. We have also issues with respect to the Supreme Court insofar as our pending cases. Out of 65 cases, I think that the average period that it is pending in the Supreme Court is 9 years, and the longest being 21 years. So again, this is something that we hope that we can get some closure on, and that's why we have been filing motions for early resolution with both courts. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman Bautista. Now, you mentioned that you would want a court that where the public will know what its goals are, so there is something to measure the performance of the court. But I think the main concern would be how you will be able to get the present members of the Supreme Court, who are more senior than you are in age, who may not have the same values as you are fortunate to have in your commission among your peers, and in judicial experience, in order to support your proposals for judicial reform?
I would like to think that regardless of age, lawyers have common principles, common values, common ways of sort of like seeing what is right and what is wrong. I would also like to think that the current membership of the court, even if they're older than I am, if ever they see a good thing, if ever they are exposed to fresh ideas and fresh insights, that they would be adaptable and that they would see things differently. So I've had this issue before in previous undertakings. Yes, it can be a challenge. But as I said, as long as people focus not on the personalities, but focus on the principles and the values and the work at hand, I think it is doable. Now, the one thing also I wanted to say was with respect to these goals and objectives, I was hoping that the court would run itself more like a, you know, like a business, in a sense that you must have work plans, you must have key result areas that you have to report on. I don't know, as you had pointed out, we started here in the Supreme Court in the 1980s. From then until now, I have not heard of any planning session or, say, strategic planning workshop that the courts would do at the beginning of the year to map out what kind of goals and objectives they would like to attain. I think this is something that they should really look into. And after that, as I said, that the time of being cloistered, that the time of being like a hermit, I think is gone, because even the Pink Sisters or the Trappist monks of Guimaras now use the internet and also text. So I think it's high time that the court open up its operations, receive constructive feedback, and I would like to emphasize the adjective constructive, from the public so that it can improve on its operations.
Moving on to another topic, you have taught constitutional law for many years. And how would you use this rulemaking power of the Supreme Court under the 1987 Constitution to address issues of delay in the disposition of cases, as well as corruption in the courts?
Right. Well, actually, I did have a little paragraph on that. So let me... I think what we should do, first of all, is that we should consider the outsourcing of the management of dockets as distinguished from judicial writing to the private sector, so that the latest technology can be used to track the status of cases. That way, judicial scorecards can be developed to effectively monitor court performance. Similarly, why should court administration be assigned to lawyers when other professionals could do a better job? Now, if a lawyer had an MBA degree as well, that would be a different story. The other thing that I think that the courts should take into account, well, with respect to specific amendments, I would say that the rules of court, and specifically the rules on civil procedure and criminal procedure, should be amended so that the filing of frivolous cases and interlocutory appeals should be minimized. We all know how Rule 65 has been abused. In that regard, we also should look at Rules 41, 45, and Rule 58. There should be a limit to the motions to postpone and seek an extension of time to file a pleading. Also, judges should be encouraged to write shorter decisions and to use language that the non-lawyer parties can understand. But also, if I may say, a major culprit for delay is in the Constitution, Article 8, Section 15, Paragraph 1. This states that the period to decide cases is counted from the time a case has been submitted for decision. But it can take 5, 15, even 30 years before a case is deemed submitted for decision. So in reality, the Constitution has not arrested, but has in fact countenanced delay. The quick fix is to amend this section so that we count the period for deciding not from the date of submission from the date of filing. Thank you.
What about with respect to corruption? Do you have any thoughts on how the rules can be amended in order to address the problem on corruption, or do you feel that the new code of judicial conduct would suffice?
If you ask me, I think that the rules are sufficient. The problem, again, is with respect to the people. After all is said and done, we have good rules. We also have good laws, but the issue is with respect to implementation. And here, and that's why, if you ask me, what would I do? First thing, I would get good people. And when I say good people, I mean competent and honest people who could do the job. So to me, the big problem of the Supreme Court is a human resources problem. Because once you get good people, then corruption will be minimized. Obviously, we will also need the cooperation of the integrated bar and other sectors, the business sector, because it takes two parties to have a corrupt transaction. So, you know, in the same light, they should work hand in hand with the courts so that not just real issues of corruption are prevented, but even perception. Because, as you know, after all is said and done, perception can become reality. And it is important that our, you know, that the people believe in the credibility and the integrity of the court system for our society to properly function.
You agree that independence is also a major factor in the courts. Now, my next question is, do you recall any specific instance where you as a public official have shown integrity and independence from the appointing power?
Yes, I do. And in fact, well, I hope I will not be violating confidences. But as you know, one of the big issues facing the PCGG is the COCO levy cases involving the San Miguel shares. And our commission felt that it was really our duty to try our best, even given the circumstances, to try and get back that COCO levy monies and the San Miguel shares back to the government for the benefit of the Filipino people. Because I think of our zealousness, I was called to Malacañang to make a presentation to the president and to the entire cabinet in respect of this issue. I do know that the president is related to Ambassador Cuanco, although I must again say that after making our presentation, the president just was nodding his head, did not provide us any instructions for or against. He just wanted to know what was going on with respect to these cases, and he has allowed us to do our job. But I must admit that it sort of like made me think twice as to how we should proceed with this matter.
Thank you, Dean Bautista. Now, may I just be allowed one more question, which I feel is quite necessary, in as much as the chairman is not only chairman of the PCGG, but also a law dean. And I also a member of the MCLE committee. What do you feel has to be done as far as continuing legal education is concerned in order to improve the moral fiber of our legal profession?
Well, first of all, I think that the moral fiber, though, will be created during the more formative years. As we all know, the older we are, the more set we can be in our ways. But having said that, with respect to legal ethics, I think the way it's being taught is wrong. It is too academic. It is too classroom-oriented. I think it has to be more real-world-like. I think that lawyers, well, law students, lawyers should be exposed to real-life situations, ask, you know, real-life questions. And that's how you really learn what is right and wrong, right? Again, here, there are many cases or there are many examples we can get from other countries. This is not This problem of corruption is not common or, you know, is not unique to the Philippines. Other countries have dealt with this problem, and successfully, I might add. So all we need to do, I think, is look for these best practices. We should not just copy blindly. We should know how to adopt these best practices to our own peculiar situation.
Thank you, Chairman Bautista, and good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have no further questions.
Attorney Mejia.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, Dean Bautista.
Good morning, Professor.
How long have you been with the PCGG, if I may ask, for starters?
Close to 2 years. I started in September 2010.
What makes you think it's now about time to move up to the Supreme Court from your present stint as PCGG's chair?
Well, I was nominated. This was not something that I was, you know, that was part and parcel of my career plans, Professor Mejia. There was a vacancy. I was nominated. I thought twice as to whether to accept the nomination, but I said to myself, why not do it? But as I said, not really to get appointed, but more to try and expose the issues in relation to the state of our judicial system.
One of the questions that I listed is to ask you what you think plagues our judiciary today. And apparently you have addressed that in some of you, in your presentation. You may have missed out something, that some of the more salient points that will address that question. I'm giving you the opportunity to mention those things which you may have missed out, given your limited time.
Thank you very much, Professor Mejia. Well, let me... Well, as I said, you know that the issues relating to congestion of court dockets and delay have been plaguing our legal system since time immemorial and require radical, out-of-the-box solutions. Also, as we try to increase the compensation of the our judges, I think we should realize that it is not practicable to fully benchmark the compensation of our judges to that of the private sector. However, the court has the luxury of appealing to the patriotic sense of a lawyer. I remember in college, well, maybe you will, that there was this poster ad that tried to recruit Jesuit novices. And they used the tagline, "Why sell soap? Build people." I was thinking that perhaps the Supreme Court can entice law graduates with a similar tagline, such as, "Why just practice law? Dispense justice." Again, this goes hand in hand, I think, with the overriding need to attract the best and the brightest to join the judiciary. If I may, again, relate to you just one short anecdote. 2 weeks ago, I asked my class of 40 students, I said, okay, ladies and gentlemen, I said, how many of you potential lawyers want to be judges? Out of the 40, only 2 raised their hands. And they said, I want to be, sir, but only if Supreme Court. Now, I think this was not how it was during my grandfather's time and my father's time. Being a lawyer, you know, being a judge was a position of honor. It was looked upon with great respect. But nowadays, I get the sense, having been teaching law for over 20 years, that that is not anymore the priority of our law students. That they only go to the courts in case they don't make it in practice, which is not how it should be. As I said, for our justice system to work, it must be able to again attract the best and the brightest.
Okay, related to that incident that you just mentioned, Dean Bautista, do you think that the present law school curriculum provides sufficient training to law students who want to pursue a career in the judiciary?
Yes, it does. Although, again, I hasten to add, and now there is a change from the rigid LLB to the more flexible JD, which I think is a step in the right direction. Essentially, the two are the same, except that JD allows a law student to specialize in a practice area earlier on. So, for example, if it is really a law student's dream to be a judge or to be a litigator, he or she can focus the subjects that he or she takes to litigation-related areas. On the other hand, if you want to do corporate law or you want to do tax, then you can take subjects that are related to these areas of specialization. I think this is a step in the right direction. This is similar to what's going on in medicine. So in terms of the curriculum, I don't think there's anything wrong, although I think we should encourage law schools to be more, to find their niches, to look for their areas of specialization, like what is happening in foreign law schools.
Why should the president appoint someone from the outside? I mean, let me be more specific. There is an apprehension that if someone is appointed from the outside to head the Supreme Court, there will be massive demoralization within the Supreme Court. How will you address that concern?
That's an excellent question, Professor Mejia. I think if you ask me, all things being equal, the next Chief Justice should be an insider rather than an outsider. And why is that? Because again, if you look at other institutions, you would like to convey the message that people can rise up the ranks. And also, you have issues in relation to experience, that somebody who has been there knows the problems and should be able to tackle these problems better. But I must say that this situation we are in is unusual, in the sense that all of a sudden there was a vacancy which was not planned. And as I said, part of the problem, if I may say that the impeachment that happened was not to me just an impeachment of a person, but the impeachment of the entire judicial system. And that is where an outsider might be able to help. He or she may be able to bring a breath of fresh air, a new perspective as to how things can be done. As I said, I think that the Supreme Court should realize that there is a credibility issue that it is facing right now, and that it cannot be just business as usual. We must do ways and means in order to repair that integrity, and I hope that this, that choosing the Chief Justice is the first step towards that improvement.
That's my final question. Good luck, Din Bautista, and thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you.
Justice Langman.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Dean, is it Dean or Chairman? How do you
Kahit like Andy lang po, okay na.
No.
Kasi kung minsan, alam nyo, isa pa yun, yung titulo. Yeah. Dito sa atin, minsan masyadong hang up yung mga tao sa titulo.
Yes.
Ako, Andy lang
but
po, okay lang.
You cannot avoid the fact that you are the Chairman of the PCGG and a Dean of a prestigious law school.
Salamat po.
So I will call you Chairman. Okay. Now, I know that you have answered the question of Attorney Cayosa regarding your age. But I feel that I still want to ask you this question. At the age of 48, if you will be appointed as the next Chief Justice, you will be serving the court in that position for 22 years, which would effectively deprive all the incumbent associate justices of ever being considered for promotion to that post. Okay, under that situation, if you will be the Chief Justice, how are you going to lead the court and get the respect, the trust and confidence of the incumbent associate justice to enable you to lead the court with moral ascendancy? Okay.
Thank you for that question, Justice Lagman.
Yes.
In fact, that was one of the questions I was really hoping that somebody would ask.
Okay, thank you.
With respect to age, I think that, as we all know, age can be good or bad. And sometimes, yeah, and now you can always hear people saying that age is a state of mind. Mm. That age can be good if you have a good person who can steer the institution for a long period of time. Mm-hmm. But age can be bad if you have a bad person who is in office for a long period of time.
Yes.
But to address that particular issue, in fact, I believe that there should be judicial term limits. In the same way that there are term limits in the executive branch, there are term limits in the legislative branch. We copied this sitting until 70. Or as you know, in the U.S. Constitution, it is not just 70, but until they are able to. Okay, we copied that from the U.S. Constitution, but we have to remember that at that time, the U.S. Constitution was ratified in 1791. I think that the probable age of people then, their longevity was only in the 50s. Yeah. And that's why they were not expected to live long. No? Yes. But to my mind, well, that one, by the way, is already being challenged. There was a recent survey in the U.S. which showed that 66% of U.S. adults believe that that should be amended and that there should also be term limits in the judiciary. So if you ask me what I would propose, we should have a 770 rule in the judiciary, meaning that term limit of only 7 years, regardless of what age. And once you reach the age of 70, then you have to retire. Okay? And as in the same way that you asked all of us candidates to sign a waiver of our bank accounts, I am also willing to sign a waiver to say that I will only serve for 7 years, if appointed.
Okay. Thank you very much, Chairman. Now, I'll go to another point. We all know that the impeachment of the former Chief Justice has affected the judiciary in a way. Now, in your opinion, what kind of a Chief Justice do we need today to regain the respect, the trust, and confidence of the people, and to restore the cordial relationships of the judiciary with the other branches of government?
I agree with you, Justice, that indeed I think that the impeachment caused a disruption in terms of how our justice system works. Mm-mm. But I believe that this disruption is actually healthy. Mm-hmm. And to be honest, I have read papers saying that maybe we should have a healing Chief Justice at this point. Mm. I think that is not yet time. I think there continues to be problems and issues that the judiciary faces that also needs further reform. So yes, again, at some point, you know, people should learn to disagree without being disagreeable. If people are just very professional in the way they do things, I don't think there will be a problem. Okay? And insofar as being able to ensure that the credibility is restored and maintained, to my mind, the solution is changing culture, changing attitude, and changing mindset. That the courts should be more transparent in the way they do things. They should be able to get buy-in and participation from the public. They should get the people more involved in their operation so that the people are not kept in the dark. Because I think that's part and parcel of the problem, that the Supreme Court is seen sometimes as a mystery, as you know, as an old boys club, as you know, secret society and things like that. The way to do it is to open it up. One of my favorite sayings is, sunlight is the best disinfectant. Open it up, let the sun shine through, and I think that the credibility of the court will be restored.
Okay, thank you very much. Now, if you will be fortunate to be nominated and appointed as the next Chief Justice, what would be your top three priorities upon assumption of office?
If I may reiterate, Madam Justice, first overhaul HR, human resources. Okay. Attract the best and the brightest. Because as I said, the work that an agency does is only as good as the people who do them. Number two, finally fix the case congestion and delay. That to me is the biggest practical issue facing the courts. And as I said, I shudder when I think about the economic repercussions of this delay. And then finally, after all is said and done, the Supreme Court should lead by example. Lead by example in terms of wiping out its own backlog, leading by example in terms of accountability and transparency, leading by example by being more adept in using technology. I think technology is a tool that can be used in order to ease the burden of the work of the Supreme Court. And the, as I said also, the Supreme Court should really reach out and let its hand go through and speak to the other stakeholders so that we may be able to really show, you know, what it's trying to do, and after its performance, it's able to really assure the people that it is here to try and improve our justice system.
Okay, Chairman, my last question. I feel that I have to tell you this to be fair and to give you a chance to comment on this publicly. Yesterday, actually, this was received by our office on July 20. A letter was filed by the Philippine Overseas Telecommunication Corporation. What is this? The PhilComSat, the group of companies, and the PHC, through their counsel, Attorney Kapunan, opposing your nomination to the position of Chief Justice. Now, they allege that your refusal to abide by the resolutions and directives of the Ombudsman, the Supreme Court, the PCGG itself, and the Department of Justice has caused irreparable damage to these corporations. Do you want to comment on this?
Yes, of course I do, Madam Justice. Okay. You know, in a strange way, I welcome this opposition because it gives me again an opportunity to preach the gospel of good governance. You know, they were saying that you're probably not doing your job in government unless a case is filed against you. So be careful what you wish for.
Yeah.
To me, it is a badge of honor if a case is filed against you wherein you are trying to protect government interest. Just by way of background, those opposing my nomination, well, Mrs. Erlinda Ilusorio Bildner, yes, is the president of PhilComSat. She is the daughter of Potenciano Ilusorio, who, according to PCGG records, was a Marcos crony. And then the lawyer who signed it, Attorney Lorna Pataho Kapunan, also, she was the daughter of a Marcos classmate, former COMELEC Commissioner and Justice Lino Pataho. One of the problems in PCGG is that you get mixed up with people from the Marcos regime. And again, most of them are back in power, and that's why it is very difficult to go against them. But just for the record, the current PCGG, okay, has, if you look at the allegations, if you look at the dates, it's all before September 2010. So we have done no wrong against PhilComSat. In fact, the funny thing is that I have been elected the chairman of POTC in September 2011, up to now. But under the bylaws, only the president and two members of the board can call a meeting. It is what, 10 months already, no board meeting has been called. Also, in respect of, again, we have not received a single centavo from PhilComSat or POTC. What we're all asking from the current management, okay, is that they be transparent and accountable in the way they're managing the company. The government has a 35% interest in these companies, which was surrendered to the government, to PCGG by the group of Mr. Campos. We just want to protect that interest. And that's why I challenge both Ms. Bildner and Ms. Kapunan, let's have a full-blown Senate investigation on this matter, because I would be more than willing to meet whatever opposition they may have.
Okay. Thank you very much, Chairman. That is my last question, and good luck.
Thank you.
Justice Hermosissima.
Good morning, Dean.
Good morning, po, Justice.
We acknowledge the arrival of Congressman Tupas.
Thank you.
Your impeccable credentials, academic credentials, have preceded you, sir.
Salamat po.
In the Supreme Court, cases are ruffled to individual justices.